Beethoven. It was a reaction to the cruel rationalism of the Enlightenment of the 1700s, a century of philosophy, and it gave free expression to extreme emotion. So you heard that emotion in the piece that we just played, in the dynamics, and in the lots of syncopation. Mozart tried his hand with that Sturm und Drang, on a trip to Italy, and they didn't like it. So he went back to his hometown back in 1773, and he tried out in a symphony, the Symphony No. 25 in G minor, which is what we just played part of. And incidentally, it's one of only two symphonies that Mr. Mozart wrote in a minor key. So there you have it. The Amadeus is from Symphony No. 25. Our next piece, Rhosymedre, and please correct me if I didn't pronounce that right, I'm not Welsh, a prelude on a Welsh hymn tune. In 1920, Ralph Vaughan Williams composed three preludes for organ based on Welsh hymn tunes. That's a set that quickly established itself in the organ repertoire. Of the three, Rhosymedre, sometimes known as Lovely, has become the most popular. The hymn tune used in this prelude reminds me of a hymn that I grew up on called Oh Worship the King. And if you know that hymn, you may recognize that. You will first hear it in the horns, and it will be brought through over and over as the layers build up in the piece. But we'll get back to the original tune. It was written by a Scotsman in the 19th century. The Oh Worship the King was written by a Scotsman, I should say. This tune that we'll be playing for you tonight was written by, of course, a Welsh composer, because it's a pretty Welsh hymn tune. J.D. Edwards, if you happen to know any Welshmen, that's one that you might know. Around this modest tune, it is a very, very, very simple tune, Vaughan Williams has constructed a piece of grand proportions with a broad arc that soars with the gradual rise of the tune itself. It's a very simple tune. It's just made up mostly entirely of scale tones and upward skips of a fourth. So it couldn't be much simpler. It's introduced by the French horns, as I said, and taken up by the other instruments as the layers build upon and thicken. The second violins and the clarinets add a very rich rhythmic component throughout this arrangement. I know they didn't want me to say that, because now you're going to be looking at them, but they have a very beautiful part that adds a lot. So we bring to you now Rhosymedre.
Thank you.
fun working with such nice people. And not only are they nice, they're sensitive musicians, as you just saw. They play with their heart. It's wonderful fun. Well, now we proceed from the sublime to the ridiculous. After all, who ever heard of a baseball euphemism for an orchestra title, right? For that matter, who ever heard of a string orchestra trying to play rock music, right? Worse yet, trying to play jazz? It just doesn't happen. Well, we're going to obliterate all of those taboos right now. And to help us do that, we proudly feature Quila Doyle on the bass. And we also thank Eagle for stepping in the last few days to help us make this possible back here on the drums. So I'd like to call your attention to the impending expressions of shock and awe on the wind players' faces as we play this, because they probably had no idea that strings could really rock out like this. And they haven't heard this piece yet, so pay particular attention to that.
Thank you.
give it a good try. The next tune is kind of special to us in a personal way tonight. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. But I want to read to you what the composer himself says about Ashokan Farewell. I don't know how many of you saw the PBS series. I didn't because I don't see much TV, but I understand it's pretty popular. And this piece had a lot of airtime in that series. You heard it many times if you saw it. Ashokan Farewell, says the composer, was named for Ashokan, a camp in the Catskill Mountains not far from Woodstock, New York. Ashokan is the name of a town, most of which is now under a very beautiful and magical body of water called the Ashokan Reservoir. Such, that's the way things go sometimes. The reservoir provides drinking water for New York City, 100 miles to the south. Go figure. I composed Ashokan Farewell in 1982, composer speaking, not me, shortly after our Ashokan fiddle and dance camps had come to an end for the season. I was feeling a great sense of loss and a longing for the music, the dancing, and the community of people that had developed at Ashokan that summer. I was having trouble making the transition from a scheduled woodland, a secluded woodland camp with a small group of people who needed little excuse to celebrate the joy of living, back to life as usual with traffic, newscasts, telephones, and impersonal relationships. By the time the tune took form, I was in tears. I kept it to myself for months, unable to fully understand the emotions that welled up whenever I played it. I had no idea that this simple tune could affect others in the same way. Ashokan Farewell was written in the style of a Scottish lament. I sometimes introduce it as a Scottish lament written by a Jewish guy from the Bronx. I lived in the Bronx until the age of 16, so he qualifies as from the Bronx. Well, filmmaker Ken Burns heard the tune in 1984, a couple years later, and was immediately taken by it. He soon asked to use it in his upcoming PBS series, The Civil War. The original recording is heard at the opening of the film, and this and other versions are heard 25 times for a surprising total of 59 minutes and 33 seconds of the 11-hour series. That has to be the composer counting all those minutes and seconds, right? The Farewell, for us, we found a personal meaning tonight in the Southwestern Oregon Community Orchestra as we prepare to say farewell after one more concert to our concertmaster of 10 years, Joanne Ogle. After our concert in May, she will be leaving us for yonder parts of Oregon, I hear. And in order to let you give her a good send-off, knowing her a little bit better, I've asked her to prepare a few little comments about her story, and I shouldn't be standing in front of her while I'm reading this. That wasn't a very good plan. So, the lovely lady in the concertmaster's chair there started playing the violin in fifth grade when she found out that once a week she could skip math class in order to attend string lessons. We music teachers have our methods. She didn't like that. That was funny. Unable to afford private lessons, she kept up with playing by joining her middle school orchestra and rose in the ranks from third violin to first violin. Boy, it must have been a big orchestra. We didn't even have third violins in this one. But then in her freshman year of high school, she became concertmaster of the orchestra and remained so for all 4 years. During her sophomore year of high school, she met her high school sweetheart and now husband of 21 years, Mark. Wave, Mark. He can't wait very much because he's holding the camera. In her senior year of high school was active as she participated in Hayward, California's solo ensemble receiving high marks, played as a strolling minstrel in the school's production of Neil Simon's Fools, and won the National School Orchestra Award, which came with the Mozart College Scholarship. At college, however, she developed some disturbing wrist ailments that required surgeries and prevented her continuing college even or playing for many years. The year 2000 brought to Joanne and Mark their first child, and it was soon evident that Joanne would need an outlet or a distraction from the heavy demands of motherhood. And finding that Southwestern Community College had a chamber orchestra, she slowly resumed playing and found, much to her delight, that her wrist problems were sufficiently healed to allow her much happiness in the endeavor. After a few years of renewing her abilities, she was back in the concertmaster seat, helping the orchestra members, conductors, and even to train another concertmaster. She's created and played in trios and quartets professionally for weddings, played Christmas tunes while strolling about private parties. I can just see you doing that. In your 5-inch stiletto heels, right? She played Christmas tunes while strolling, I read that, and recently played as the fiddler in A Christmas Carol. That is Joanne Ogle. I'll make her take a real bow later. Ashokan Farewell. This is a community orchestra, not just in name, but in fact, made up of your friends and your neighbors. I think you should know your neighbors. I think your neighbors should be your friends, no? Well, I'm going to introduce you to one more of our orchestra members right now. In fact, I'm going to let him speak for himself. This is my friend. He's not my neighbor, but he's my friend. And he's not just my friend because he has come to my house and helped me chop wood and spend many pleasant hours with me. He's my friend because of the quality of person he is, and I choose my friends carefully. This is Slavik Gerega. He's going to tell you, is that name right? He's going to tell you a little bit about himself, and it's interesting.
Thank you all for coming. I got started on this wonderful instrument when I was also in fifth grade. My method of choosing was a Goldilocks method. Violin is too small, bass is too big, viola is too close to the violin, sorry, no offense, violas. Cello is just right. I've been playing it since I was 10 years old, and I'm grateful to my parents for supporting me with limited resources, to my teachers, the late Paul Fisher, George Simonson, Christopher Leach, among my string teachers, and I've had opportunities to serve my community and my neighbors through my music. I've played in church ensembles, community orchestras, the Southwest Community Orchestra in Washington State, and music has personally enriched my life. I joined this community college orchestra when I moved to this community about 2 years ago. I looked for an area to continue playing, and I think I logged onto the college website and found this, and so this is my second year playing, and I'm grateful to be playing with this group of musicians, and it's also been a great way to creatively give back to my community. My day job is working at the hospital, and I have the privilege and opportunity to serve people who are sick with cancer. And so I do that every day, and I have a chance to musically express and give to my community. And so that's a little bit about me. Thank you.
And should you like to know more, come up and talk to him afterwards. He has a very interesting story. One more piece we have for you, The Dance of the Tumblers, from the Snow Maiden Suite, by one of my favorite composers, Rimsky-Korsakov, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov. But before we present our finale, I'd like to say once again thank you for being here and helping us to add beauty to our community. Now, you have a part. We'd like you to take this little bit of beauty that we are providing for you and spread the word so that more of our community can share in what's happening here. We have a little bit of elbow room, so if you can each tell 5 or 6 people and bring them with you, then we'll be a little bit more cramped, but it'll be fun. We like I said, we have loads of fun in our rehearsals, but it's a whole lot more fun being able to share it with you. So, about Dance of the Tumblers. How would, say, an ordinary Navy lieutenant with no formal musical qualifications land a musical professorship? Well, suppose that he happens to compose as a hobby, and some big shot academics just happen to discover his practical compositions. This isn't an idea for a corny 1930s Hollywood musical, but actually it is how Rimsky-Korsakov got his big break. In 1871, he became a professor of practical composition, what else, at St. Petersburg Conservatory. So as by now you know, he was in Russia. The Snow Maiden Suite, and the other clue, by the way, how you can tell he's Russian and not Polish, does anyone know what the other clue is? I thought so. So I will tell you. Polish people, if they end in ski, it's spelled with an I. If they're Russian, it's spelled with a Y. Just saying. Now you know. So, the 4 short movements of the Snow Maiden Suite provide an undemanding and wholly enchanting quarter of an hour, not too long, telling the story of the mythical unification of frost and spring to produce an offspring called Snow Maiden. In the celebrated Dance of the Tumblers, which is Act 3, it's actually the fourth part of the suite because there's an introduction, then Act 1, Act 2, and Act 3. The Tumblers were troops of multi-talented outdoor entertainers. Rimsky-Korsakov casts his dance in a classical sonata structure. For those of you who are music history buffs out there, music appreciation, people who enjoy that. It's complete with a development section and an invigoratingly intensified reprise and a veritable whirlwind of a coda. Here the musical magician's wand busily showers us with spells of sparkling sound. I didn't write that. I just read it.
Thank you. Wally Tarubio's place. And fortunately, we had Don here come and sit in with us and play his trombone. And then he agreed to conduct for us, and we're just extremely, extremely happy and grateful. Love you, Scott.
My reward is just coming home every Tuesday night after having so much fun with them. I just love it. So come back again in May. I can't tell you the exact date, but we'll get it out there on the radio and in the newspaper and everywhere you turn, you'll see us. Bring your friends. Thank you again for coming.